Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Lilkindy. Today I'm going to talk to the Senate Deputy Majority Leader about the big picture, what the governor's budget means to you and New York taxpayers. Hi, Senator DeFrancisco. How are you today?
I'm doing well. Thank you.
So since the last time you were here, the governor put out his amendments to his fiscal plan that he laid out in January. Do you have any more details from before?
No, the amendments really didn't add anything. You know, he gives a broad picture in a speech, and the broad picture doesn't have much detail, and that's what we've been trying to get to find out the details in the budget hearings that have been going on for the last month. And then when, some commissioners are more forthcoming with details, some don't know the details because the governor controls a lot himself, and it's difficult to get the answers, not because they're not answering, but they don't necessarily know either. So I just think we at least got a better picture of what the proposals are, but some of the blanks are not filled in. For example, minimum wage. Now, let's apply minimum wage of $15. Now, that wasn't some study that was done as far as the inflation or cost of living or anything. That was just a group of people that have been calling for a minimum wage of $15 an hour politically, mm-hmm. as a group of progressives throughout the country. And so the governor took up that chant and appointed a wage board. The people he appointed, the result was pretty expected it. It was not a big surprise that they said, oh yeah, we think the wages for fast food workers should go up by $15 to $15 an hour when it just was raised in December. So without any basis other than it being a political position the governor wanted to take. And that started it off. Now he's talking about across the board. So what about the charities, the nonprofit organizations? They'll have to comply. It'll take less, it'll take more money out of the actual good that the charities are doing, or they're going to have to get rid of some employees. It's not going to be made, the money's not going to be made up magically. Or with healthcare workers, for example, at nursing homes. Every year the fight is we haven't had a reimbursement from the state to help us pay our expenses for these nursing homes, and now there's not only is there not an increase to keep up with the cost of living, there's no money put in the budget to offset this increase. Or you could go across the board. The Catholic Conference came in and said, therefore the $15 minimum wage, but we need the government to throw in more money to the pots of money for nonprofits. And, you know, my comment was, well, that's a very principled position. You're for it as long as someone else pays for it. But farmers and small business owners can't pay for it. It just doesn't magically get paid for. They either got to raise prices or they've got to get rid of employees. And a perfect example is the fast food restaurants in Washington, the state of Washington. They were saddled with a $15 minimum wage increase. They started putting kiosks in your first stop in a fast food restaurant. Logical. And those are the things that are going to happen. And it's so frustrating because the governor puts out a report that's supposed to justify it, and it's not accurate. I'll leave it at that.
You have introduced legislation about the governor's REV program, Reforming Energy Vision. Last year, you asked for a cost-benefit analysis. Right. You didn't get that. You got called out by an environmental group that you were stalling things. But now you want legislation just to be able to have more power over what the governor says?
Well, first of all, billions of dollars is being spent by the PSC, the Public Service Commission, based on some of these charges that you get on your utility bill. Extra charges to go in for projects that supposedly help the environment. And the people that are responsible for divvying up that money are the Public Service Commission. And they passed a resolution. I tried to get them to stop and do a cost-benefit assessment first. They already passed a resolution saying over the next 10 years, $5 billion is going to be divvied up among clean energy type projects. Now, that's pretty much abdicating the responsibility of government to have a non-elected group of people making those decisions. And so what I felt that since we've had some reforms in various agencies and authorities that are separate and apart from the government, that are run by appointed people, there's a PACB board, a board that reviews some of their activities. And I felt with this kind of money being just divvied up by non-elected officials, that those same rules should apply. And there should be a cost-benefit assessment before you just throw money at the latest environmental thing that might sound sexy at the time that we're talking about it. And so that's what I want to put in the budget, because it's got to be oversight. It's got to be accountability. Mm-hmm. And so when the governor appoints the majority of the members, I think pretty much so, he's the guy who's going to make those decisions. And there's too much of that going on, and it's got to be stopped.
Right. Speaking of cleaning up the environment and hazardous materials, another upstate community has contaminated water supply, PFOA linked to cancer. We talked about Hoosick Falls. So now the governor has responded with a water quality team, emergency management.
Well, this seems to have been going on for some time now.
Yeah.
And there's been concerns by at least some residents there for some time. It's now that it's been proven, now the water quality team is going to be put in place. It seems to me that there ought to be some type of oversight by the legislature by way of a hearing of some type to find out what happened. Mm-hmm. How is it that a citizen could ask for the testing of their water, and that all of our agencies and authorities that we've got that taxpayers are paying for, what happened? Did they ignore something? Did they fail to look into something they should have? And if so, it's not necessarily to say, okay, gotcha, you're the bad ones. The point is, if it's a problem, we ought to know about it so it doesn't happen again.
Yes.
And we don't end up paying, this taxpayers paying hundreds of millions of dollars, because that's when it's going to end up for whatever problems occurred before. So it's nice that the governor's doing that, but there's got to be a more thorough investigation so that it doesn't happen in other areas.
Yeah, it does seem like there's local water issues happening, popping up all over the place.
And we, part of it is due to the failing infrastructure and the infrastructure,
yes,
in the state. And how many times have you heard me on this show talk about we've got to spend money on infrastructure? Here's a perfect example.
Comptroller DiNapoli recently released findings of an audit that really hurts the dignity of people living in nursing homes and homeless shelters.
It's an environment that takes care of people that are vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
If it's found by the state that there are violations and there's fines or there's assessments placed on those organizations, why isn't it being collected? I mean, the state's a big state. There's a lot of issues. But what concerns me is a part of the role of government is to make sure that the state laws are enforced, and that if there's something wrong, that the penalties are obtained and changes take place. And when you see all of these things happening at the same time, you wonder about, you know, how the agencies are really doing their job and whether they're doing it effectively. They're hard jobs, but that's what the comptroller's there for, and hopefully the corrections will be made.
And there's a lot of health and safety issues in the homeless shelters.
Exactly, and that's seems to be an ongoing battle with the governor, and especially the mayor of the city of New York, and you know, where it's not safe to be in some homeless shelters.
Mm-hmm.
If government wants to take over everything, which it seems to be moving more and more towards, with some of the candidates for president and some of the local leaders, the government's got to do more. Government's got to do more. Well, if you can't do what you're supposed to do with what you do now, why are we taking on more and more responsibilities? We should make sure that the laws and regulations are followed and people are safe and the laws are being upheld. Rather than coming out with another responsibility make it look like we're providing more and more for people. You know, we're going to give you this more and that more and this more, but if the stuff that you're already required to do isn't done properly, it's not doing you much good. And mm-hmm. I may sound agitated, but I just, it gets frustrating after a while that you keep saying the same things about government. The government can only do so much, and if you're going to take on the responsibility to do something, you better do it right before you take on more responsibilities, promise more things to people that you can't possibly do effectively, this is what happens.
Now I want to ask you about paid family leave. How does this get done? How does it get paid for? Is this a surcharge on employees, or does the state fund this?
Well, once again, the broad general language in the governor's budget doesn't really tell much, except that what it tells me is that the governor is on his progressive horse, running as far to the left as he can, whether it's to the left of de Blasio or to the left of Sanders for whatever his next step may be, because it's twice the amount of weeks. California is shown as the model state. They provide 6 weeks of paid family leave. The governor's proposal is 12. Now, can you imagine being a mom and papa organization, say a little cleaners or a little pizza shop or whatever, and you've got 6 employees and 2 decide they're going to take paid family leave because their parents are ill. Maybe legitimate, sometimes it won't be. How do you replace those 2 employees? How does this business keep going forward? And that doesn't even account for the additional costs that are going to be associated with hiring somebody else need to hire, or 2 more people. So it's, once again, it's a progressive policy that where there's no numbers behind it, in my mind, that justify it. Obviously, I would love to give everything to everybody, but if you can't, and you're going to end up sending more and more small businesses out, you put minimum wage together with paid family leave in 1 year, there's going to be, we lost 2 Congress representatives last year because our population went down in comparison to other states. Keep this migration going out, and you're going to have fewer and fewer people paying for it, more and more people leaving, and fewer and fewer jobs. So it's another added benefit whose cost has not really been fully thought out in my mind.
Now I want to ask you about taxes. The governor says there's no reason or appetite to take up taxes this year. The assembly speaker has put out a tax the rich plan. What is the Senate stance on tax policy this year?
Well, we would like more tax reductions. My specific policy is more across-the-board tax reductions, so small businesses and all businesses benefit from it, not just sending $70 million to one project in the city of Syracuse and say you're fighting for economic development, but rather giving all businesses the same opportunity to make money and hire people and grow. That's what our policy is, and the Assembly, on the other hand, wants to tax more of the rich. The rich have the greatest mobility of anybody. They can leave anytime they want, and they could leave effectively without losing much by doing so. So you're just sending people away, and the rich, by the way, pay the bulk of all the taxes in the state of New York. So it's always this knee-jerk, we got to give more, how can we pay for it? Oh, the 1%. If you got 99% voting for you, you're going to keep winning. Nobody, the 1% doesn't have enough to say that it's bad policy. But to me, it's bad policy. And secondly, the governor says do nothing about taxes. Well, he's doing a lot about taxes, because if he's going to end up taxing business by more expenses, by the minimum wage, and he's going to be taxing people, it might not be a formal tax, but it's an additional business expense by paid family leave. He's taxing the small businesses primarily that are dependent upon being able to afford an extra employee or to try to make their business successful and grow. You can't grow in this atmosphere.
Mm-hmm. It's hard to really take things at face value these days.
It's not only government. You know, you watch the news every night, you wonder whether you have gone crazy or whether something is something's amiss. I don't know what the situation is, but it's very difficult because everybody can find a report or get a study that says anything you want to do. Mm-hmm. The problem is the constituent has to look into it and really understand who's blowing smoke and who's not.
I want to remind our viewers before we go that their voice matters and you are listening. So let the senator know if these big picture items that we talked about today are of your concern. DeFrancisco.nysenate.gov is all of his contact information there. That's his website.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being with us, Senator.
My pleasure.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information and to keep track of the budget process, defrancisco.nysenate.gov.